Throughout his life and ministry, Jesus befriended all kinds of people, even some of the most immoral people living in the towns he traveled to. This made the Pharisees, the religious leaders of Jesus' day, furious. They would complain about Jesus spending time with these people. Often, Jesus would tell short stories, called parables, that illustrated the way he felt toward people with bad reputations. One day, Jesus told this story. A man had two sons. The younger of the two sons came to him one day and said that he did not want to wait for his inheritance, but he wanted it now, before his father died. So his father agreed, giving him half of his entire wealth. The son, showing no self-control, took his inheritance, gathered his own possessions, and traveled to a distant country. There, he lived a wild life and squandered away all of the money his father had given to him. Soon, a famine hit the country he was living in. He had no food to eat and no money to support himself. So he found a job taking care of pigs. As he worked with the pigs, he was so hungry that he wished he could eat the food the pigs were being given by the workers. But no one gave him anything. Then, the son came to his senses, and he came up with the plan to return home to his father, ask forgiveness, and ask to be a hired hand on his father's land. As he was returning home, while he was still a long way off, his father saw him, was filled with compassion for him, and ran out to meet his son. When the father reached his son, he threw his arms around him and kissed him. "Father," the son said, "I have sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son." Before the son could even ask his father to take him back as a hired hand, the father called out to his servants, "Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast to celebrate, for this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." So the man and his servants began to celebrate the return of his son. As they did, the older brother, who had remained home, became angry and refused to enter the feast. The father came to his older son and pleaded with him to come to the party. "Look," said the son, "all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours who squandered your property with prostitutes comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him?" "My son," the father said, "you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad, because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found."
Good morning. Welcome to New Hope Church. It is great to have you here today, and it is great to be here today. It was what an exciting adventure that many of us have been on, eight of us, over the last 2 weeks. Tell you a little bit more about that in just a minute, but if you are visiting New Hope today, great to have you here. I would love for you to take a visitor card in the pew in front of you, fill it out, drop it in the offering bag when it comes by. We'll not beat on your door or bother you on the phone, but through the mail, let you know what goes on around New Hope. If you've got prayer requests, you're part of the regular church family here, we'd love to know what's going on in your world, so give us some information. You want to meet with one of the pastors, let us know. We'll do our very best to accommodate all those things, all right? So thanks for being here and taking the time to do that. As most of you know, eight of us got back yesterday from the Ivory Coast of Africa. Man, were we in for a huge surprise. I will tell you, everything about this trip was the hardest thing any of us have ever done in our lives, all right? I got David to confirm that in last service. Robin, are you in this one? She's teaching Sunday school. And Steve and Lee are in the next service. And so Shelly, you're the 915, all right, representative today. Is this the hardest thing you've ever done in your life? All right, and would you do it again? All right, that's what's hard to explain to folks. It is the hardest thing we've ever done in our lives, and yet absolutely we'll do it again. In fact, almost unanimously, that's kind of a lousy thing to say, almost unanimously. It either is or it isn't. Unanimously, everyone said they would do it again, and unanimously, they're all talking about making the trip again next year, all right, and making preparations. But it is. It's harder than the previous two trips. Temperatures were as high as 125 degrees out in the village. Humidity, which I did not warn them about because I'd not had it the last 2 years. Humidity was 80 and 82% almost every day. So it was really hot. It was really, really humid. All right. These are some of the harshest conditions. All right. When you're out in the village, I mean, there is not electricity. We are in a village. All right. If you don't have it with you, you don't have it. All right. And you can't just go to the corner store and get a replacement. All right. You start before sunup. You don't end and go to bed till 9:30, 10 at night. In those temperatures, the nights don't cool down much. And so it's very challenging. 2.5 days of transportation to get there, 2.5 days to get back. 18 hours of that 2.5 days, 18 hours is covering 400 miles. Do you know how far you ought to go in 18 hours here in America? All right. You ought to be able to get to Albuquerque, New Mexico in less time than 18 hours, okay? And we went only 400 miles in 18 hours. There were miles and miles. We were going 5 and 6 miles an hour. And it is just the ruts in the road. So just everything about it is challenging. But the blessing was when we arrived in San Francisco. And we are all excited about, we're 3.5 hours from home. We can't wait to get to Los Banos to stop for a hamburger. All right? That will all of us mutually agree. Hamburger, Los Banos. Mark picks us up in the van that he delivered us to the airport in 2 weeks before. And we said, Mark, let's get going. We can't wait to get to Los Banos and have a hamburger. He said, I got some bad news. Can't stop in Los Banos. That's exactly why I said, what? And he said, no. He said, the plane can't land in Los Banos. He had a 10-passenger jet, private jet, borrowed from somebody that he knew, picked us up and flew us home in 40 minutes. So Colorado Grill got my hamburger last night, all right? I had to have a hamburger. But anyway, just a quick sampling. We will schedule the next 4 to 6 weeks a Sunday evening where all 8 of us can be here. Joe Fish, as you know, now lives in Nevada, but we'll try to work it out so Joe can join the rest of the 7 of us and join us for a Sunday night, and everybody can share their stories and answer questions and show you pictures. But we've got, show me the team picture, if you would, please, first. This was a real joy that surprised me. Didn't know about this. Actually made me cry a moment or two. This is the end of the dormitory that you all provided the funds to build, all right? This houses 35 7th and 8th grade students that successfully completed elementary school in this village way back in the bush. They have to travel 6 miles each direction to go to junior high. This Christian teacher who started this school wants to make sure they stay in because their parents don't want them to stay in school. The fathers want the boys in the field and the girls. They want to sell for 1 or 2 cows, often marriage, at 12 years of age. And so this dormitory was built, so it's near the school, near the teachers. 2 rooms, 1 for boys, 1 for girls. David Dunlap led the construction team to build 18 bunk beds. 9 in each room for the boys and the girls. Ladies in the church made quilts. You all provided sheets. So they now have sheets, quilts, beds, tables to study and eat at in their dormitory. 2 months ago on that spot where you see that building, it was just dirt and bush. And they painted it and then they named it. And I didn't know they were going to name it till the dedication ceremony, and they drove us out there and we pull up on this little dirt road, and there on the end of that building, Dortor, that's dormitory, New Hope. And so that was really, really exciting. And there are your 8 New Hopians there, all right, standing underneath that sign. Now, there was a service on that second to the last day we were there. It was a dedication service, and we handed over the keys to the dormitory. A lot of dignitaries from that region showed up. They show up for the honors. They don't show up for the work. but they did show up that day, and that was good for 1040i in that region. There were probably, I'm going to guess, there were probably 250 people, 300 people there, all right, at this event outside, 118 degrees, all right. In front of this building, out on the front porch that's built there, were tables, and on those tables were the 35 quilts, and there were 35 backpacks. There were 35 of the bicycles that you all donated money to buy, 35 bikes, so these kids now can ride their bike 6 miles instead of walk 6 miles each direction to and from school. So they were given bikes, bike locks, backpacks, a bed to sleep in that's got a mattress on it, sheets. They've never seen sheets before. Never seen sheets before. They have a handmade quilt from you ladies here at New Hope. Water filters, the Denhartogs donated funds. Each one of them got a bucket that has a water filter on it that they are to take back to their parents as an appreciation for their parents allowing their kids to get an education. And that water filtration system will take care of 1 million gallons of water on that one little filter in that bucket. All right? So all of that was done that day. And the villagers for the Kids Fest, all right, that was done 4 days. And, man, your women that you see in that group along with 5 other women from Oklahoma and West Virginia and Campbell. So California and Oklahoma did the Kids Fest, 160 kids every day. On the last day, between 50 and 60 kids prayed to receive Jesus Christ in their hearts. All right, so that was incredible. That was exciting. And so the villagers wanted to show their appreciation back. And so they gave some gifts to 1040i. And it was a wood carving. And it was some bags of inyams, which are their version of potatoes. And then they gave about 6 chickens. Okay? And you got to understand, that's huge. That is huge because that's a prime commodity for them. And they're alive still. They're tied at their, you know, at their feet. And they bring them out. Well, they wanted to show particular appreciation to the pastor and pastor's wife who made this possible. So the next slide will show you Shelley receiving her gift right there. All right. And that bird's alive, all right? And that is the first chicken she has ever held in her life. And she suggested afterwards it's probably the last one that she will ever hold in her life. But anyway, and you can see in the background there, all right, the table stacked with the quilts. You see the bike behind my leg, and between the wheels of the bike, you'll see a little bit of the blue water filter. All right, there's a bucket that's there. And then you see a lot of people taking pictures of that very special, sacred moment, Shelley holding a chicken. But anyway, that's just a little bit. That's about all we'll share about the trip today. But thank you for your prayers. Thank you. Remember, you all were there, all right? Not everyone can go. Not everyone is sent, all right? Not everyone is called, but we all share in the whole thing. You gave, you prayed, and here's what I can tell you. New Hope was represented very, very well by every single one of those men and women. I could not be more proud of anything ever in my life than watching all of them work as hard and as tenaciously as they worked. Yeah, what an incredible, incredible experience. Well, let's get on with our announcements now. There is a lunch today, I understand, at Yosemite Falls Cafe here in Clovis. Widow to Widow, there is some information in your bulletin about that. So right after the third service, that will be taking place at Yosemite Falls. They would love to see you ladies come and join them and share in that this first of what they hope to be many lunches. Young Married and Family Social. Nick, you want to stand up and say anything about that? To your place? You'd like to hear from some folks today? All right, give them directions if you're going to go. You'll be in the pavilion? Okay, all right. And what time? Give them a little... And it's my first time to be able to say Pastor Nick, all right, because he went to work while I was gone, all right, and jumped right in, and that's great. If you find yourself as a young married and young families, you're in that kind of that ballpark of 24 to 40, all right, this is kind of a kickoff, wants to get acquainted with some of you and begin to plan some direction and future things in ministry here with that particular age group. And so flip back around so I can read my notes. Here we go. All right. Easter Choir, I'm not passing the sign-up sheets around. Easter Choir started last week. It'll be going on again this Wednesday night, 7 o'clock. If you can sing at all, you can carry a tune. Be in the Easter Choir. Show up this Wednesday night. Get started. Easter, the number one day in history. The most important day in the history of the world. It's more important than Christmas. See, if Easter didn't happen, there would be no Christmas. Easter is what validates Christmas. And there will be people who will walk in the doors of the church on Easter Sunday that won't darken the door any other day. And your engagement, your involvement can make such a huge difference in that. So we'd love to have you in the Easter Choir. There's a note in the bulletin about the parking posse, all right? I think it said something. This is not a new movie. It's a new area of volunteer that you can do around here. But the 9:15 to 10:45, our parking lot's a bit of a chaos. We'd like to make it easier, particularly for visitors and for seniors, all right, to know where to go and how to get to places faster in the parking lot when it's a little congested. So follow the directions that you find in the bulletin. You'll be hearing more about that in the weeks to come. Ladies, your road trip is next week. I think you all already know about that. Women's Retreat registration. Many of you signed up to go to the Women's Retreat. Today, money starts coming in. Registration takes place out there with Regina, all right, out in the pavilion after the service today. This next one, tomorrow begins a big day around here. And we're going to start the first phase of three phases of campus improvements around the church, all right? We started talking about this a little over a year ago. Things are underway. The first two phases, money's in the bank to take care of, and those are going to get launched. It starts with the remodel of the Murbach building. That will become our complete children's center, all right? From pre-K all the way through sixth grade in one building, completely remodeled and redesigned inside so that this is a great place for young families to come and be, all right? That starts tomorrow after Easter. Then the project will start kicking out the back end of the sanctuary, adding 27 feet to that and getting another 14 pews in here, all right, so that we can seat about 120 more people. And so that will start right after the Easter time. Any of you ever done remodel at your house? Did it go as you planned? Were you inconvenienced? Okay. Understand, now multiply that by about 500 people, okay? So what we're going to have to ask is extreme patience and cooperation, all right? Because some of this won't take very long. Others of it will drag out. There's always going to be a certain amount of surprises. And so today we get started. And volunteers, what you are able to do reduces our costs, all right? So that there's more for the next project or more for the unexpected, all right? And so one way in which volunteers can help starting this afternoon is after the last service, so about 12:15. We need to empty out, all right, the end of the Murbach building, all the tables and the chairs, the bookcases that are in that room. All of that needs to be taken over into our storage building. So any of you who are able to do that, that would be very, very helpful, all right, because things are going to start tomorrow. Sunday school for the next few weeks, parents, are going to be a mess, okay? We can't tell you this week where your kids will be next week, okay? We'll have it figured out next week when you show up, all right? We'll have people out there directing, and it may be different each week, so we're going to ask for your patience. The end result, now, after your remodel, were you happy? Okay, all right. So when it gets finished, everybody's going to be real happy, but in the process, it's going to be a little tough. And if on Monday or Tuesday some of you are not working or you're retired, there are still cabinets that we need to get off of walls. And the more that we can do as volunteers then, the better it is on the bottom line of the things that we have to pay for. So though this is all going to start tomorrow. Our reception areas and various things are going to be changed drastically. A lot more burden is going to be on the bridge. So 8 o'clock service, if some of you are out of the wrong service today, you normally come to 8, but you slept in today. It's going to be in the bridge starting next week. So Just know things will not be as they've always been. Please be patient with us, and it will end well. I promise you, it will end well. A few prayer requests. I understand Mikey's infection's all cleared up, and she has been cleared for surgery. She's going to get a knee back. Maybe. Hopefully. All right. Okay. All right. But the infection is cleared. Okay. Okay. That sounds good. Stephanie's having surgery this week. Be praying for her. Bud Vale, I understand, had been in the hospital. He is home now and recuperating. Louise Ward had a pacemaker this past week. So all the updates that Gene shared with me this morning, so continue to pray for God's best in their lives. There are a variety, several memorial services this week, so pray for the Paris family. The Sharton family, Donna Sharton, both her parents passed away. And it'll be a double service on Thursday of this week. Elmer Harpain passed away. That's a service on Friday. And then Aaron Stonehouse passed away at the end of last year. That service is going to be this Saturday as well. So just please be remembering those families during that particular time. I'm going to ask our ushers to come wait on us this morning as we have our tithes and offerings. Would you join with me as we... No, I'm not sending those around today. Oh, yeah, no, no. Well, Easter Choir, just show up Wednesday night. They already started, and the other one's the women's thing, and they're full. So go see Regina. Hi, guys. Okay, oh, so who's filling in for her? Okay, all right. Then it'll probably be next week then, all right? All right, let's pray. Father, thanks for life and the privilege of sharing life with you. Thank you for the opportunity, Father, to see life in a really, really different perspective than what we live here in the United States. Father, we've been blessed. It's not our own choosing. We didn't get to control where we were born or to whom we were born to. Father, sometimes we take so many things for granted. Safe water every time we turn on a faucet to drink. Clean floor when we step out of a shower. A refrigerator filled with choices of a variety of things to eat. Microwave that cooks in seconds rather than hunting to find wood and finding a way to start a fire and then cooking. Father, a doctor just around the corner and insurance for most of the time to cover those expenses. We take so much for granted, and yet there are so many in the world who have none of that. They spend their entire day looking for something that is safe to drink, something that is safe to eat, and a place to put their head down for a little rest at night to do it all over again tomorrow. So, Father, I pray that the things that we have seen and the things that we have heard will create within us a far deeper appreciation and a far bigger heart of generosity, that we will exhibit your character in our lives. And so we simply say thank you for your blessings, and may you use us to add your blessings to the lives of others. We're grateful for those who are improving with their physical health, and we continue to trust you for their needs. We share with you the needs of those whose hearts are in pain, Father, because of the absence of someone and someones who they love very, very much. And that is where knowing personally that you were our Savior takes a lot of the sting out of death, and knowing that those that we love have you as their Savior takes a lot of the sting out of death. So we trust you for these needs. We thank you for this day and what you want to teach us. In Christ's name, your Son, our Savior, we pray. Amen. Good job, Mila. Last Sunday morning, at this same time in Ivory Coast, Africa, a little time difference, but at the worship hour, I was in church. And I got to preach. I was in a village church preaching through a translator. About 90 people probably in this mud-walled, thatch-roofed sanctuary. And oh, did they worship. Oh, we'll show you a picture on that Sunday night. All right, I got some video of them worshiping. And oh, do they know how to worship. They love God. At the end of that service, we had a baptismal service. I got to baptize 12 in a bathtub. First time. That was the first experience. And then something else, and I understand when they shared a little bit this with one of the services, there was confusion of what it was. And so let me just kind of clear that up if I can this morning. I was able to pray over the burning of fetishes. In their culture, a lot of their worship are to handmade idols. Sometimes it's a bowl, sometimes it's a wooden figure, sometimes it's a feather off of a bird, and they place them on a shelf, and there they offer sacrifices and their prayers for good crops, for fertility, for sometimes the casting of spells and spirits on others who are their enemies. And when they come to know Jesus Christ, they must rid their huts, their homes, of their fetishes. And they have a burning service at the church. And it's a little more intense because the husband and the wife have to answer questions of the pastor. One, are these all of them? Are there any more hidden anywhere? Are you ever going to bring any in again? And there must be agreement. And then a prayer is offered, and then the pile is set on fire, and they are burned. And it's a picture of the old life is finished, and the new life for them has begun. So this was a trip filled with a lot of firsts. Also did a wedding in Africa. It was one hot wedding, let me tell you. Let's look at today's subject. Subject number 4 in the key virtues. If you're visiting New Hope, this is week number 24 out of 30 in a series called Believe. We spent our first 10 weeks looking at 10 key truths, the foundational truths of the Bible that we can build our life on. The next 10 weeks, we looked at 10 key practices. Once you know the truth, put the truth into action in your life. So what are the 10 key practices that create and develop within us healthy Christian growth? And as a result of believing in those 10 key truths and participating in those 10 key practices, 10 key virtues, 10 characteristics of Christ Himself will be produced in and through and out of our lives that will be to our benefit and to the world's blessing around us. And so we are in that last one-third looking at those 10 key virtues. While I was gone the last couple of weeks, Pastor Gill shared with you about the subject of peace, the peace of God that passes human understanding. That is one of the virtues that comes out of the practices and the truth. And the week before that, Tim Kepler shared with you on the subject of joy, and that's one of the fruit of the Spirit. As we believe the truth and as we practice the truth, then this fountain of joy is created in our life that is not dependent upon the things that happen to us, but it's built upon the relationship of the one who lives within us. And today, we will be looking at key virtue number 4, which is a life that is under control. Quick question. On a scale of 1 to 10, 1 being completely out of control, 10 being perfect control, where would you put your life at this very moment? Don't answer out loud. Where would you say your life is? Preacher and pastor Dwight L. Moody, Moody Bible Institute, Moody Bible College, Moody Press, all gets its name from this incredibly gifted preacher of another generation. Dwight Moody loved to study the Bible. Is this a fire drill? I feel like I'm in school here. Dwight Moody loved to study the Bible topically. He liked to take a theme, a subject out of the Bible, and just study it till he could wring everything out of that word that he possibly could. It occurred to him one day that he had never studied, and I find this fascinating, knowing Dwight L. Moody, he had never studied the subject in depth of the grace of God. Not once had he taken the time to really explore grace. So he set aside a day, and Moody gave himself an entire day to study God's grace. At the end of that day, he found out it wasn't enough. And so he took a second day. At the end of the second day, he realized that wasn't enough. And even the third day, Moody had discovered he had not finished the task of studying God's grace. At the end of that third day, he was so excited, so filled, so running over with this subject that he just had to talk to somebody about it, but nobody was around. So the story goes, he ran out into the streets and he stopped a complete stranger and he said, "My friend, do you know anything about grace?" The man was a bit surprised by the question. He didn't know who Moody was, and he looks at him and says, "Grace who? Grace who?" And Moody said, "Why? The grace of God that brings salvation to all who will believe." Moody then left the stranger standing on the street corner, scratching his head, wondering about who is this grace of God he's talking about. Most of you know we have a couple in our church, Joe and Mary Avalon. They've got a daughter named Grace. And as I read that story, it dawned on me, I bet a lot of Grace's friends, the only thing they know about Grace is they have a girlfriend they grew up and went to high school with whose name was Grace. There's probably a lot of folks just like that who don't know anything about the grace of God. It's not just a name. The subject of grace is a key characteristic of God's nature. For by grace are we saved through faith. Without grace, there would be no salvation. For by grace are we saved through faith. It is not of works. It is a gift of God, so no one can brag or boast about it. We sing a most amazing song called "Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound That Saved a Wretch Like Me." God is the God of all grace. God is the God who is a gracious God. And what you and I must discover today is that grace is exceedingly powerful for the needs of your life and for mine. Let's discover how powerful it is by looking at a couple of verses that the Apostle Paul wrote to another young preacher, not Timothy this time, but a guy by the name of Titus. And in Titus chapter 2, verses 11 through 13, or you'll find in your Believe Bible on the very first page of that fourth key virtue, you will find these two verses. For the grace of God has appeared to all and offers salvation. So what does grace do? Grace makes an offer. It offers salvation to any who are willing to listen. And once we have received what grace has to offer, and what it has to offer is salvation. Salvation is the forgiveness of our sin and the presence of Jesus Christ to come live within us, so that in this life we have God in us, so that after this life comes to an end, we are with God. It's a beautiful exchange that God has provided for us. That's what salvation is. And in the meantime, grace is not finished. It not only provides for us this offering of salvation, but then it teaches us. Grace has something to teach us. Grace teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions, to live a life that is under control, a life that is upright and godly. When? Right now. In this present age, not later, right now. While we wait for the blessed hope. And what is this incredible hope? The appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. The Bible, in a variety of places, refers to our body, to our human life, as well as the sin that we create by the choices that we make. It often refers to this part of us that is the body, human nature, sin. It often refers to that with this label. It's referred to as the flesh. You are living out of the flesh rather than out of the spirit. It's that story up here of two people trying to sit on one stool. Okay? And so the flesh is our own desires that we have, and we'll investigate that a little more closely in a moment. But you see, you and I act out by the stimulation of our sin nature. Flesh wants to take care of itself. Our fleshly nature wants to be first, no matter the cost to anybody else, including, ironically, the flesh wants what it wants, even to the destruction of itself. You saying, huh? Think about an alcoholic or an addict. Think about somebody engaged in an addiction of sexual sins. Some of you are saying, I'm relieved. I don't have any one of those issues. Okay, how about over your head in debt because you can't stop spending? The flesh wants what it wants to its own destruction. Who's sitting on the throne making the decisions in your life? The flesh wants to be there. The flesh causes damage even to the point of its own destruction. In our natural state, remember, we were born sinners. We are separated from God because of sin, essentially having no choice but to opt out for selfish decisions. While we can make some good choices, just like you can teach a dog how to behave in the house, we sometimes can teach ourselves how to behave more politely. Any of you remember reading the book in junior high? Help me out. You know the one I'm thinking about. You do. The boy stranded on the island. Lord of the Flies. Yeah. Okay. I remember the sociology of that book. All right. Some good boys, some, you know, boys kind of on the edge, some troubled boys, but all of them now isolated on an island left to themselves. And tyranny begins to take over. That's a picture of us separated from God. While we can make some good choices some of the time left to ourselves, we're going to make a lot of bad ones. But as our key scripture in Titus explains, the grace of God offers salvation to us and it gives us a new choice. In every instant, we can now choose our own way, the way of the flesh, or we can choose God's way, the way of the Spirit. We can say no anytime we choose by obeying God. Through Christ, we can practice a life under control rather than a life out of control. So the key question for today is this: how does God free us from our sinful human fleshly nature and its habits and addictions? Now, just one brief commercial for Eric. Every Thursday night, celebrate recovery. Hurts, habits, hangups. And it's not just. Everything you are going to hear today is everything they cover on a weekly basis, week after week after week. It's about growing in the grace and the knowledge of Jesus Christ to overcome all these things in our life. Jesus came to earth in the flesh. He was born as a human being on this earth so he could redeem our humanity. As we talk about self-control, we think about the taming and the overthrowing of our fleshly nature. And here's how Paul deals with it in another one of his writings in the book of Romans, chapter 8, verses 3 and 4. Paul says this: when the law was powerless, what the law was powerless to do because it was weakened by our flesh, by our sinful nature, God did this, God dealt with it by sending His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be an offering for our sin. And so He condemned sin in the flesh in order that the righteous judgment of the law might be fully met in us who do not live according to the flesh anymore, but we now walk according to the Spirit. What the Old Testament law could not control through legislation, grace accomplishes with loving kindness. I want to say that again because this is big. In the Old Testament, the Ten Commandments tried to control through legislation our human nature, but the battle for that stool was still going on. And the flesh won a whole lot more than the Spirit of God did. Legislation does not control behavior. Grace accomplishes, though, in us with loving kindness. As the Father ran to the Son was willing to submit and yield to the will of the Father again. When you and I understand the depths of the love of God for us and what He does, grace teaches us through the loving kindness of God to say no to those things which are destructive for us. The revelation of God's character in action, which is the fruit of the Spirit. These 10 key virtues is the revelation of God's character. When that is in action, it's lived out by God's people in light of God's purposes, so that your life and my life will be blessed. And in the blessings that we receive, we pass those blessings on to other nations. And that is what you all got to share in as we engaged in another country over these last 2 weeks, taking the blessings that God's grace has given to us, allowing those blessings not just to be hoarded in us, but to be shared with those who have no clue to the kind of blessings you and I have here today. That is what God wants to do in and through every single one of us. That's what it means to be who we've already become. Essentially, there is a constant internal attack going on within every one of us. Every single day, you and I deal with issues just inside your own life. There are temptations, there are thoughts, and there are attitudes that flow through us every single day. And it's a battle to see who sits on the throne. Who's going to get their way? I hate it when God teaches me lessons. But one particular night on this trip was a struggle for me. It had been a hard day. Looking forward to sleeping that night. It was a miserable night. I was not sleeping. Shelley wasn't sleeping very well. And the annoying thing is everybody around us were snoring. And they're tense. You could hear them. And I'm laying there starting to have a little pity party with myself. God, how come they can sleep and I can't? God, I need rest for tomorrow. I can't be all that you want me to be if I don't get some rest tonight. And then the words of one of the songs that we sing almost every morning during kind of our morning manna sessions before we started our day, and it came to me that night, but it's not coming to me today. Shelley, that love never fails, love never gives up, love never fails, never gives up, never runs out on me. That's it. And that night I remembered those words. And so I start singing it in my head. Love never fails, never gives up, never runs out on me. And about the 10th time through, I'm saying, God, I think it's run out. And then he reminds me of a man who had surgery that day. 85 surgeries done the 9 days we were there. And I'm going to gross you out just a little bit. I'm sorry. There was a man who came in one day, a little shorter than I am. Thin, wiry. Big, baggy pants on. One of the translators brings him and says, hey, can you find a doctor? He's got something he really needs to show the doctor. And I said, well, they're all in surgery right now. Can you tell me what this is about? And the translator said what I said to this guy, and this guy undoes his belt and drops his drawers. One of the big problems for men in that country is what's called hydroceles. It's kind of like a hernia that instead of protruding from your gut, it drops into... You everybody got the picture? Okay. There, you know, you get so familiar, you just say all the stuff, and here it's a little more sensitive. And on top of that, it wasn't just a hernia that had dropped into his sac. His intestines had fallen into him. And so it's hanging to his kneecap. They did that surgery that day. He's laying in a post-op tent. Post-op tent, remember, we're in the bush. This post-op tent, the air conditioning is a fan at both ends of a large tent. And the doors, the tent doors are open. That's the air conditioning. At times, inside that tent, it was 125 degrees with the fans blowing. Love never fails, never gives up, never runs out on me. God, I feel like it's run out on me.
him, there's a man laying over there in post-op who's had his guts fallen out of his stomach. And he's had it all put back together, and he's lying over there recovering, and his pain medication is Tylenol. Love never fails, never gives up. God, it's not running out on me. And the pity party stopped. And that lesson was going to do me good 3 days later that I didn't know. Because our trip to the airport to come home, we got in the traffic jam of all traffic jams. We had plenty of time to get there, and now we're cutting it down. We have 35 minutes left just to show up at security, or they will close the security gate on us. And we're in a traffic jam. There's a roundabout. There's four roads coming into this roundabout. Something got clogged up in the middle, so you got three lanes going east and you got three lanes coming west. And when these three lanes got backed up, people in the back end that were going east decided to take the three lanes going west and make it a one-way street. And all there were nine lanes in a six-lane road all going the same direction, and people on the far side were doing the same thing coming the other direction, and there was this tangle in the middle. And people are starting to get antsy. Bruce Wood is sitting behind me, and I whispered to him, God will make a way somehow. And then Bruce begins to sing that song. You have moments like that. Who's sitting on the throne? Are we going to have peace or panic? Are we going to trust or not trust? You know, we could have been there another 24 hours. If that had happened, you all would have been blessed because it would have been a shorter sermon today. Okay? But we have choices like that. The point I want you to understand is from inside of us, there are these temptations and these attitudes as we face every moment of life. And I watched it in the life of every member of New Hope there. Every single one had a crisis moment during the week. A moment when they didn't think they could do anything else. There was nothing more. Quit! And you watched them say, discover, love never fails, never gives up, never runs out on me. We have choices. Who's going to sit on the throne? There's this internal attack. But there's another influence that we must also deal with. These problems don't just come from within us. But listen to what John wrote in his first letter. 1 John 2:15-16, do not love this world, and don't love anything in this world. For if anybody loves the world, love for the Father is not in them. For everything in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, this does not come from the Father above. So we have this internal pressure, and now we have this external pressure. The world is a destructive external force on us. These scripture verses define the world as lust from our hearts brought on us from wanting all the things that we see. With pride as the ultimate root of a systemic problem. From this reality, it's certainly no coincidence that right in the middle of this word pride, we find a big fat I. We're right in the middle of it. Whether the motivation to place self first is coming from our internal source or an external one or even both, the flow of communication is the flesh telling our will what to do. The flesh is bossy. The flesh is a bully. It wants to control our will. Here's a good question for us to ask ourselves. Who's sitting on the throne? Here's a question. What do I crave? Do I crave peace, patience, joy, peace? Or do I crave chaos, frustration, anger, a get-even spirit? What do I crave? That tells me who's sitting there, flesh or spirit. So what do we do? How in the world do we counter this constant attack? We turn to John 15, and we discover in that chapter that the nutrients of the life of Jesus Christ flow, and it uses this farming analogy from the vine. Jesus is the vine, the source of life. We are a branch. And when we have been grafted into the vine, by grace, salvation comes to us. We are grafted. A dead branch is plugged into a living vine. And the life of that vine now flows through this branch. And the ultimate end result is the fruit, not of the branch, but the fruit of the vine now is produced at the end of the life of the branch. Is fruit being produced in you? When we remain in Him and He in us, He will produce His life. But we must crawl off the throne and onto the altar and die every single day. Sometimes the best way to fully understand a concept of self under control is to redefine it and look through different lens. So let's look at the key idea through a couple of possibilities. The key idea for today is I have power through Christ to get my life under control. Christ in me is the power source that gets my life under good control. Self-control is described in the book of in Paul's writings as this. It's love, joy, peace, goodness, gentleness, a life that is under control or self-control. And I think the best way to understand it is to use the term God control. I'm not in control. If I'm in control, that's flesh. But what I am going to do is yield myself to the authority of Christ in me and let Him produce a life that is surrendered to Him. I must yield. I must let God take command. In fact, self-control is best achieved when harnessed to the practice of total surrender. Gene in the 8 o'clock service sang a song for us, led us in singing, I Surrender All. There must come that moment in our life to where we say, God, I don't want to be in control of anything anymore. Total surrender. Paul draws a powerful analogy in the book of Ephesians, chapter 5, verse 18, when he says, do not get drunk on wine. Why? Because it leads to debauchery. But get drunk. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. Here's the choice. Fleshly nature, wine, the spirits of the wine control your behavior, or the Holy Spirit of God controls your behavior. When we allow an excess of alcohol, let me say this differently. Some people drink with an intent of getting drunk. Some people do. I understand. The vast majority of folks don't drink with an intent of getting drunk. They just don't say no. And they drink more and more, and now they're under the influence. Okay, I got under the influence while I was gone. Somebody gave me an Ambien one night, thought that might be helpful. Nobody bothered to tell me later that there's lots of things where people walk around naked under the influence of Ambien. I did not do that, all right? I did not do that, but there is a small video somewhere that shows I was silly. So what are you under? Don't be influenced by the wrong spirit. Be influenced by the Holy Spirit. The analogy is powerful. Negatively, when we yield to the wrong spirits, the power of alcohol and drugs, they usually end up with negative consequences. In the same way, as we yield to the Holy Spirit in our lives, it always ends up with positive consequences. Self-control is not about trying hard. It is about yielding fully. Self-control is yielding to God's power to do the things we should and to not do the things that we shouldn't. The writer in Proverbs uses the protective walls of a city as an analogy for self-control when he says, better a patient person than a warrior, one with a life under control than one who takes a city. It's better to have a life under control than it is to be a victorious warrior. Like a city whose walls are broken through is a person who lacks self-control. The distinct point here is that a person who is successful at a life under control has won a greater victory than a warrior who conquers a city. This is an effective defense against the influence of outside forces. The key application, what difference does all this make in the way in which I live? If you read today's newspaper, the Fresno Bee, or pull up any news feed from any store, from any town, small or metropolitan, you will read stories of people who lost control. There are stories today in the newspaper of murder, of hostage taking, of assault, of abuse, of drunkenness, of sexual crimes. The list goes on. The common denominator in every crime that ends in a mugshot on the news is a person who gave in to a behavior in which he or she was tempted to engage, whether it was a temptation from within or a temptation from out. Granted, there are some people who finally get to a point in life, they don't care what the consequences are, they're going to do whatever they want to. But the vast majority will eventually regret that they could not contain their emotion or feeling that fueled the fire that now consumes their lives. Imagine how many people sit in jail cells today who would say, I would give anything to be able to go back in time and control my actions differently. Since none of us are exempt from temptation and sliding down a slippery slope to decadence, allowing a life to be under control, to be a growing and active virtue, may just not only save our lives, but as we allow the grace of God and all of its power to save us, we may in turn be the source whereby others in our family, in our familial relationships, and in our friendships, where others are saved as well from self-destructive behavior. As we develop the virtue of self-control, our sin will decrease and our character in Christ will increase. We will learn to say, along with John the Baptist, the cousin of Jesus Christ, the forerunner of the Messiah, when at the pinnacle of his popularity, John the Baptist said, "He, Jesus, must increase. I must decrease." Have you come to that point in your own life where it wants to be less and less of you and more and more of him? The grace of God teaches us how to live. Did your mom and dad, as you were a kid growing up, ever tell you no for something? Sometimes it's very, it wasn't to be mean. No, don't touch the hot stove. It'll hurt you if you do. No, you can't steal that. You have to pay for it first. There were times they wanted to control our behavior. They tell us, no, you can't have everything that you see. They disciplined us. They trained us. Proverbs 3:11-12 says this, "My son, do not despise the Lord's discipline and do not resent his rebuke, because the Lord disciplines those that he loves. As a father, the son he delights in." As you've sat here this morning, we've talked about your fleshly nature and my fleshly nature. Have you gotten a little aggravated, annoyed, and agitated? Has it frustrated you that maybe we're pushing on an area in your life that you'd rather we leave alone? If it is, you need to understand that's God doing some discipline in your work, in your life. That's God saying, here's an area of your life my grace can be powerful enough to bring victory in your life from if you will yield to me. But I'm not going to fight you for the stool. I died on a cross for you. I will not fight you for the stool, the control of your life. Will you yield it to me? If you're sitting there and you know you have issues, whether ones we've mentioned or all kinds of others that are out there, and you have felt nothing apart from, I wished he would hurry up and shut up so I could go have breakfast. If you have felt nothing, then it's probably because you have no relationship with God at all. Because this verse tells us God disciplines those that he loves. I felt so much better last night when this was brought to my attention that the night I couldn't sleep and God used these various things, that was my Father discipline, giving me discipline in my life. And though I hated it at the moment last night, I fell more deeply in love with the Father than I'd ever been before, because it was a reminder, God, you love me. You don't want your children to be whiners, and I was whining. You were growing me up at another place in my life that I'd missed. Thank you. And so maybe what you need is a relationship with him. He's running to meet you right now. The late Wilbur Chapman used to tell about a Methodist preacher who often in every sermon always talked a lot about sin, and this guy meant no words. He defined sin as that abominable thing that God hates. I could just hear it now. A leader in his congregation, one of his biggest contributors, came to him one time and asked him if he would stop using that ugly word sin in his sermons. And the pastor looked at him and said, the gentleman said to the pastor, "Sir, I wish you would not speak so plainly about sin. You talk about it so much, our young people will be likely to indulge in more of it. Call it something else, such as an inhibition or an error, or it's a little twist in our nature." "I understand what you mean," the pastor said. And he went to the cabinet behind his desk and he pulled out a bottle and he looked at the bottle and he held it out to the gentleman and he said, "Sir, this is a bottle of strychnine. You'll see on the label in bright red it says poison. Would you suggest that I change the label and paste one on that says wintergreen, minty, fresh taste?" And why don't you put that in your kitchen cabinet? You see, the more harmless the name, the more dangerous the poison will be. It may be that one of our problems today is we don't understand sin as sin. We like to make it sound better, not so bad. And I believe that's happened in our world. It certainly has happened in our educational system. In the movies where sin is socially acceptable and it's even laughable, we have not called sin by its first name anymore. And that's one of the reasons people do not honor God with their daily lives anymore, is because, He loves me anyway. The Bible says the grace of God teaches us to say no to some things. Put to death whatever belongs to your earthly nature. Sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, greed. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk like that, but put those aside. And don't stop there. Get rid of anger and rage and malice and slander and filthy language from your lips. Don't lie to each other. Since you have taken off your old life with all of its practices and you put on a new life, live now in the knowledge of the image of the Creator who saved you. Are we living in that image? Sadly, many people, including many Christians, go the way of society thinking it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. I need to wrap this up. Our connection to others is empowered when we increase a life that is under control. Our relationships with one another will be far better. Disagreements, arguments, angry outbursts, misspoken words, misguided emotions will be held at bay when our tongue is under control. We'll become a better spouse, a better parent, a better family member, a better employee, a better church member. And so if we allow God to work on us and overcome our flesh, life will be better. The late George Gallup Jr. was a good friend of Randy Frazee, who organized this study, and he helped significantly in putting together these 30 key ideas of the Christian life. In one of their all-day sessions in Princeton, New Jersey, they were discussing this issue, this virtue of self-control. And Randy, using his own words, says, "I was pontificating proudly on how Christians just need to get their act together and be self-controlled." George Gallup Jr., always kind and gentle, stopped Randy and said, "Randy, you're not an alcoholic, are you?" Startled by the question, Randy said, No, I'm not." And George Gallup Jr. said to Randy, "Well, I am. My father before me was an alcoholic. When I took my first drink, something happened to me that doesn't happen to everybody. I was hooked and I couldn't stop. Even when I became a Christian, I tried and I tried and I tried and I felt so defeated. It was ruining my life." And he said, "Randy, in a moment of quiet desperation, I heard Jesus whisper to me, 'George, if you never lick this thing, I still love you. I died for the struggle in your life. And I still love you. I love you deeply, George. I sent my son to die for you. I love you deeply, George. I raised him from the dead 3 days later. I deeply love you.'" George Gallup Jr. paused for a moment, reflecting on that tender encounter with the Savior, and then he said, "From that very moment on, I haven't had another drink, and it's been 30 years. And he said, "You see, it was through Christ's love and grace, not by trying harder, but by yielding all of my life to the power of the love and grace of God, it was gone." George said, everybody won't have that same kind of moment, but it is that truth that will liberate everybody at some moment in their life. When Christ returns, our blessed hope, having been made a reality, we will see brand new bodies that are free from this internal infection of sin, and we will no longer have bad attitudes and temptations challenging us from the inside. We will then live eternally in this new grand heaven and earth where self and human fleshly natures can rule, but only God exists. Sin and its devastating effects will be wiped out forever, so there'll be no more pressure from the outside and no more pressure from the inside. Billy Graham tells a story about a little child who was in a pretty nice store. And he started playing with a valuable vase. If it was cheap, it would be a vase. This was a vase. And he put his hand into the vase, and then he couldn't get his hand out. And the store clerk tried desperately to get the boy's hand out, and the father tried very hard to get the boy's hand out, and the clerk had called the owner, and they thought they were going to have to break the vase, which was going to break the father, to get the boy's hand out. And just before they broke the vase, the father said to his son, "Son, one more time. Here's what I want you to do. I'm going to illustrate. I want you to open your hand and point your fingers. Point your fingers all, make it as small as you possibly can, and then withdraw your hand." And to their astonishment, the little boy said, "Oh, Dad, I can't put my fingers like that, because if I do, I'll drop my dime." And thousands of us in this country are like that little boy. We are so busy holding on to the world's worthless dimes that we cannot accept the liberation and the freedom from our fleshly nature. We need to drop the trifles in our life. We need to surrender all to the Master. We need to let go of the stuff and the sin and let God have His own way in our life. And we will be amazed at the difference it makes. You need to pray a prayer like that song. Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. You are the potter. I am the clay. Mold me and make me after your will. Have thine own way, Lord. You are the master still. Let's pray. Father, you know those who are facing either internal and or external pressures at this very moment in their life. May they let go of the dimes. May they let go of the values of this world, and open-handedly may they receive the power of your grace to be overcomers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Have a great afternoon.